Nobody listens. Let's all rise up. Let's get to our seats. Let's get closer together because we're family. You know why the world celebrates Halloween? We celebrate our freedom in Christ. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Amen? All right. Well, we are free, and let's proclaim that to the Lord. Jesus, for the freedom that you have bestowed upon us, Lord. Freedom from death. Freedom from our sinful nature, Lord. We thank you for your unfailing love, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Nothing can separate, and nothing can separate, and even if I ran away, your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, I know I still make mistakes, but you have no mercy for me every day, your love never fails. You stay the same. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid. strong and the waters deep. I'm not alone here in these open seas, 'cause your love never fails. The chasm was far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side, but your love never fails. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. Oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, 'cause I know that you love me. You stay, you stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, 'cause I know that you love me. Your love never fails. Thank you, Jesus. Your love never fails. Your love never fails. Your love never fails. Your love never fails. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. Even when we don't understand, you make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, 'cause I know that you love me. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, 'cause I know that you love me. Your love never fails. 'Cause love never fails. Your love never fails. Your love never fails. My Jesus, your love never fails. All things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. Lord, let your glory fall. Lord, let your glory fall. As on that ancient day, songs of enduring love.
And then your glory came,
and as a sign to you
that we will love the same,
our hearts will sing that song. God, let your glory,
God, let your glory come.
We sing, you are good.
You are good. You are good. And your love endures. You are good. You are good. And your love endures. You are good. You are good. And your love endures.
Voices in unison,
voices in unison, giving you thanks and praise, joined by the instruments, and then your glory came,
your presence like a cloud
upon the were overwhelmed because your glory came.
Sing, you are good.
You are good. You are good. And your love endures. You are good. You are good. And your love endures. You are good. You are good. And your love.
Was made,
and then your fire came, then knelt upon the ground, and with one voice they praised.
Sacrifice,
a sacrifice was made, and then your fire came. Then knelt upon the ground, and with one voice they praised.
You know, this morning I'm just sitting here and we're worshiping and we're going to continue doing it. And I'm thinking about each one of you, and I'm thinking about the things that you go through from however long, last Sunday after church until now. You know what I mean? It's almost as if the moment we leave the sanctuary, the safe place of this worship and the fellowship that we share together, the enemy comes in like a flood, doesn't he? And just begins to bombard. I'm thinking of others who might have had victories this week, who have just testimonies of God's power just being shown in their life. Thinking about the women from Joy Renewed that last weekend were up in the mountains of Big Bear. And God's glory showed up, where his power came in such a way that there were physical healings. You know, Janae had an accident where she wasn't able for quite a while to move her arm more than this. And I talked to her and she said, I moved my arm up to here. And God, in an instant, touched her life. God does that kind of stuff. Do you believe that he does? For others, just had a total Acts chapter 2 experience, you know, where... How do you explain it? An onlooker would say, what are you, drunk? You know what I mean? An onlooker who didn't know the Lord wouldn't understand the power of God falling on people, where they begin to weep uncontrollably, where they begin to even laugh with the joy of the Lord, where they begin to fall and they lose their footing, not because somebody's pushing them down, but because they feel the presence and the power of God. Where somebody uses their gift, the gift that God has given them, to speak into the life of another person, to where it's real. You know what I mean? The difference between sort of staged religion and real talking to people about what you believe God is saying on their behalf. And then the receiver of that is just like, wow, how did you know? It's because our God wants to communicate to you. Our God wants to touch you with his power. Our God wants to heal you. Our God wants to restore you. And I just want to say, I've got to imagine that in a room this size with people that are everyday people like me, like you, that we need a touch from God. And isn't it better just to go for it? Isn't it better just to say, God, I need you? And so this is what I want to say to you. If you need a touch from God, if you desire more of him, I can't think of a better time than to just cry out to him, whether it's where you're at in your pew, whether it's in the aisle, whether it's at the altar, would you just come? And if you're one who is walking in victory, I'm thinking of Tiffany, I'm thinking of different ones who've just had this special touch from God up in Big Bear. I don't know all of the women that were there, I know some. But would you come and just spill out on us too? Would you come and as others are in need of a filling of God, God uses his people as an instrument. He uses the gift of God in you to touch somebody else. And so let's be the body this morning. Let's be the body of Christ. Let's minister to one another. And so I want to open the altars as we sing, but I also want to give space to those who just need to be quiet with the Lord. That's what it is. This is a sanctuary. Let's get with God. He desires to touch you, all right? So let's do it.
Sing a sacrifice.
A sacrifice was made. And then your fire came, then knelt upon the ground, and with one voice they praise,
and you are good,
and you are good, you are good, and your love endures, you are good. You are good, and your love endures. You are good, you are good, and your love endures. Today, sing, you are good. You are good, you are good, and your love endures. You are good, you are good, and your love. Good, and your love endures today.
You are good.
You are good. You are good, and your love endures. You are good. You are good, and your love endures. You are good. You are good, and your love endures. And I bring my life. song. No greater song to you on the earth. Sing a greater song.
Thank you, Jesus.
No greater song to you on the earth.
Sing a greater song.
Sing a
found me just as I am. Lift your hands, empty them.
Empty-handed, but
as we sing, majesty.
Majesty. Majesty.
Forever I'm changed.
Of your majesty,
majesty,
we sing majesty,
proclaim majesty,
majesty. Grace has found me just as I am,
empty-handed,
empty-handed.
All control of our lives, Lord. Release all control, Lord. Let your Spirit rule our lives, Lord.
Speak to me, lead me, be my voice. Speak to me, lead me, be my song.
Sing it from your heart.
Speak to me, lead me, be my strength. Speak to me, lead me, be my life.
Speak to me.
speak to me, lead me, be my voice. Speak to me, lead me, be my song. Speak to me, lead me, be my strength. Oh, speak to me. To me, lead me, be my voice. Speak to me, lead me, be my song. Speak to me.
Desire to touch your people, Lord, that's who you are, that you're a God who pours out, and so we receive from you. Lord, we thank you that each time we come, it's significant. Lord, each time we get together, it's a life-changing moment in the making. Some of us, we need our lives to be changed. And so, Lord, in this time, we submit to you. And that's what I want to invite you to do now. As we sing this last song, would you just submit yourself to the Lord? Would you rest in his loving kindness? Would you rest in his faithful love? Would you rest in his mercy and in his grace? And then allow your heart to be just split wide open so that he might be able to pour into you what he desires to pour in. Let's just give him permission now. Let's give him permission to do whatever he desires to do in our life. Let's just sing together.
Let's sing, I love you, Lord. Let's just sing with our voices. There's so much unity just with our voices together.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice
to worship you,
to worship you,
let it be.
Let it be a sweet, sweet sound.
Let it be.
Let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear.
Amen. 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 God, let it be a sweet sound. Lord, let our worship to you be sweet, Lord. Lord, let it be pure. God, let it be pleasing to you. There's a picture in the Bible that speaks of our worship being like incense that flows. It's kind of like it flows upward to the throne of God. That incense is a pleasing fragrance to God. And that's the expression of our lives lived out obediently to him. It's not the pitch that we hit just right or that tone that we sing just perfectly. It's the expression of purity from our life being offered up as a living sacrifice to him. And God, we submit ourselves to you now and we declare that we are yours. We belong to you. As a church body, God, here today, we walk in unity and we say, Lord, let our life expression, let our unity, God, let all that's within us be a pleasing aroma to you, God. And we thank you and we praise you for your goodness. We thank you for the way that when we pour out to you, you pour into us. It's just so difficult for our finite minds to understand how such an awesome God would love us so much. But Lord, we receive it. That's all we can do. We may never understand the depth of your love. But one thing is for certain, that we can receive it. And so, Lord, we choose to do that now. Submitted to you, we receive your love, God. We receive your love, which sometimes quickens us to change. Lord, your love, which sometimes even wounds us a little bit, God, as we realize we've got to work on certain areas. And so as your word comes forth, Lord, let it achieve its purpose today. God, let it encourage those who need encouragement. Lord, let it rebuke those who need correction. God, let it teach those who need teaching and instruct us all, Lord, into the ways that you desire us to walk in. And so, Lord, with that, we just say we love you and we honor you here in this place. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen, amen, amen. You can be seated. You know, this morning, I want to ask our ushers to prepare for the offering. And as they do, just a few announcements that we have to bring. If you were with us, maybe just a show of hands, if you were at our annual business meeting 2 weeks ago, just raise your hand and then sway it like this. And sway. No, I'm just kidding. No, yeah, good job, Joanne. That was wonderful. Joanne was just rocking that arm sway. If you were at that meeting, we discussed different things. We had reports and a little video from each one of our pastors, and we also took some time to talk about, should I just pray for the offering and then you guys can do, let's do that, and then I'll keep talking. Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness financially to us as individuals. You're our provider. You're our Abba Father, which means you're our dad and you take care of everything. And we thank you also for the privilege to give back to you. According to your word, Lord, as we give our tithes and our offerings today, bless them, Lord, multiply them, extend your kingdom through these resources, and bless your people, I ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. They're going to receive the offering. I'll just keep talking, but we gave a report kind of like what we saw God doing in our church, and one of the last things that I shared in my section was this desire that we had to change the name of our church, and not to change it completely, but to change the expression to the community so that it was more clearly defined who we were. Does everybody remember that? Does anyone? Yeah, and I wanted to follow that up because there's a process that we need to walk through in doing that. But let me just give you some scriptural background as to where we're coming from. When I began to just feel this quickening and started to discuss it with the staff and different ones, it wasn't because we wanted to be cooler or we wanted to have a zippy new marketing approach. It was because I just felt like God was leading us into the next step. And in Scripture, we get the understanding that we go from glory to glory. It's always a walk with God. We're progressing, right? And you remember, anytime there's any tweaking of a name in the Bible, there's a season that changes with it. And when I say tweaking of a name, I'm thinking of the first name of Abram, right? Abraham got this call of God, and he was, what was Abram? Abram meant an exalted father, right? It meant he was a really good dad. And he was so good that he was willing to leave the comfort of his home and just obey God on a go for it, and he went, right? And so with that, I keep in mind who we are as a church, that our heritage doesn't go anywhere, that we have had a solid heritage in the Lord. And then there came a point where a promise of God came to Abram. And remember what God said to him, I'm going to make you what? The father of many nations. And at that point, his name just went from Abram to Abraham. And you could still see who he was, but you could see the growth that God wanted to bring in him. And so that's just a little scriptural background. You can trace that idea throughout the rest of the Bible, whether it was Saul turning into Paul or Peter going from Cephas to Peter. And our idea is just simply this, that instead of being Zion Christian Center, which can sometimes be confusing to people, I've had the experience in talking with folks in our community. They say, what's a Christian center? Is that like a church? You know, and we've had people from just driving in and asking if they could use our reading library. So you go with what you want on that. Others might just have a misperception of what we are. And so this is a clarification. Our desire is to change it into Zion Community Church. We want to build into our name that we're a church and that we believe in the idea of the New Testament that talks that we're to live together in community. That doesn't mean we're all going to move in together, but that means that there's a sense of sharing that we have with one another, right? That we bear one another's burdens, that we walk with one another, that it isn't just this cold sort of check in your time clock. I went to church and then you bail out, which we don't have. We want the community of Orange to know that this is a place of community, and secondly, that it's a church, and that as a church, we want to reach the people who need Jesus. So that's the vision behind the subtle tweak to the name change, Zion Christian Center to Zion Community Church. And what we're going to do next week, I'm going to put a little bit of an insert in the bulletin, and in there, I'll just reiterate what I just said in a short little blurb. And then you'll have an opportunity to say, if you're a member, you can check a box. And if you're not a member, you can check a box. We don't care. We want to hear from everybody. And in there, we want to know, what do you think? Yes or no? And if not, just you have an opportunity to give a little feedback. So at that point, we'll be together. We'll know where we're heading. And so fair enough. Anybody? I'm not going to ask if you have any questions because I'm not going to take them right now. But if you do, if you want any kind of clarification whatsoever, please call, ask the questions, ask the hard questions, and write an email, whatever you need to do. We're wide open to talk and dialogue about this however you desire, but that's where we're heading, and so you can expect that next week. Be thinking and praying, and maybe God's going to stir something in your heart as he's stirring in ours. You know, what does this season change mean for us as he's doing new things in our life? So that's that. Speaking of that membership meeting, there at the meeting, we had probably about 15 people who signed up that wanted to become official members of Zion. And that's just a way of saying we believe in the vision and the values of your church and we want to join officially. I say this each time. It doesn't mean you get treated better or different. It just means you take a greater responsibility in the life of the church. And so if that's something that you want to do, you want to join that list of people who signed up, please communicate through the bulletin or give us a call or an email. We'll have two membership classes, and then on December 12th, there'll be a membership Sunday. And speaking of all that, I'm just kidding, one thing after the other. I'm the announcement master this morning, sorry. The last thing, Tuesday, please go and vote. Please go and vote, okay? I went to the mayor's prayer breakfast this week, and the speaker gave a statistic. He said, evangelical Christians, the statistic is under 30% show up to the polls. Under 30%. And so I know that the political process can be disillusioning sometimes, even frustrating. And yet at the same time, we have a duty as believers to vote the morality of the Bible, to vote what it is of our values, and to make our voice known in that way. It's what we've been privileged to do as Americans. So if you're confused about some of the ballot issues, some of the propositions or candidates or whatever, research them. The internet is a wonderful thing, but make sure that when you're researching on the internet, you go to a reputable website. And the way that you can do that is you can look at who endorses that particular site, and you can pretty much tell a cheesy website when you go on it. Like if somebody made it in their basement, you know, the graphics show it. But look at some of the organizations. Traditional Values Coalition, I know, is one that in the past has provided voter guides and things like that. But also, Martha Ming has just been a wonderful resource, and she's a studier, and she's got a son who is in politics, the mayor, and running again in Laguna Niguel. And so, anyways, that's not a plug for him because this isn't Laguna Niguel. All that to say, she's got an interest in these issues, and she's willing to dialogue with you to share what her research is if you have specific questions. Martha just waved to everybody. And I'm sure there's others too, not just singling out Martha. She's just one who said she'd be available. But ask your friends. Sit and talk about it. Read these things through. Wrestle with it. Don't just go for the easy answers. And I know it's difficult. That's why there's only less than 30% of us that go to the polls. So let's just engage this year. And that's my plug. So God bless you and have a great day. Just kidding. Okay. Would you turn in your Bibles to the book of Ephesians? How many of you were with us last Sunday? If you weren't here last Sunday, I really strongly encourage you to go on the website and watch that message from Lillian Nichols. What a phenomenal journey that she took us through, really, from the 1970s all the way to present time, where she just fireball for God. She didn't come. I loved it because it was so simple and true. It was just like, well, you know, God called me to go halfway around the world, and so I did, and learned a language of a tribal people and lived among them barefoot in a cute little dress. Hey, did you like those pictures? And I learned the language, and I wrote it for them, and then I translated the New Testament, and they all got saved and formed a church, and praise God. Isn't that? I was like, what? It was phenomenal. There was one point in her message when she talked about the word for forgiveness. It just almost fell apart, you know? What is the word that they used in their Bene language was kaleia, I believe, is how they pronounced it. And she was saying how she was trying to discover the secrets of the gospel or the treasures of the gospel that were already built into the culture. And that alone is worth really discussing, isn't it? That God, in his infinite creativity and his wisdom, that he creates mankind in his own image, and he places eternity in our hearts. And so it's a matter not of trying to talk people into Jesus. It's unlocking that idea that he created you in his image for a purpose. It sort of changes the way that we look at evangelism. It's not a hard sell. It's not, you want to buy some Jesus? This is the reasons why. It's the understanding that you are created for a purpose and that God loves you, all mankind, for God so loved the world that he gave his son. And it's unlocking that for a particular culture. Or I'm even thinking to myself, for subcultures or popular culture, that when we look at our world today, instead of being so frustrated, and granted, we have reason to be from some of the immorality and the issues that we see, but we can become so offended by those things that we miss the opportunity to learn that particular values or the whatever it is in that culture and help them to see how that needs to be tweaked. Let me give you an example. If somebody was so totally passionate, let's just pick gang warfare, for example, in LA. You know, what a horrible idea that young people would be killing one another, right? That they would commit and connect to this core group of people and that they would live together and just do anything they would for that particular gang. And understand this, that is nowhere in the design and the intention of God. But what kind of passion does it take? What kind of faith does it take to commit to that kind of cause? It takes a lot. And so if in my belief, if you can unlock that passion and that belief and tweak it and redeem it and turn it towards the things of God, I got to tell you, I know some people who had lived in that lifestyle before. And when they turn on to God, when they get an understanding that they're created for a purpose, forget it. They're so sold out and passionate. The same passion that they lived for in darkness, they move on and they're passionate for God and the light. And that's kind of the understanding that I'm getting to. And that's what she helped me to understand as she unlocked these mysteries or these hidden treasures of culture. But the idea of God's grace, the idea of this understanding that at this memorial service, you remember the story, I'm going to retell it if you don't, that they didn't know the word. Every word that they found for forgiveness was just too weak. But in their culture, when somebody dies, somebody has to pay a price, right? If somebody dies, somebody pays a price. And so as they stood before and they listed off all the particular individuals and the clans of the village and they read through, if your name wasn't read as forgiven or as whatever the particular word was, I want to keep saying the wrong word, kaleia. If your name wasn't read, kaleia, I mean, you're released from the blame as that word is spoken. But if you're not released from the blame, then you have to pay the price. And man, you just think, wow, how awesome that God put that mystery, that secret, that eternity in the hearts of that culture, and he's put it in you, and he's put it in me, and he's put it in the darkest regions of the world, in the darkest, ugliest cultures of the world, in terms of bad choices to follow evil, that God has redemption for all people. And I'm thinking of that this morning. And so it led me to Ephesians, and A passage of scripture that I'm sure you know, but today is October 31st. It's when many people will put on all kinds of crazy costumes and try to scare one another. I don't get it, you know, I don't understand. Remember as a little kid, just why would you want to freak somebody out? What is with that, right? 5 years old, and I remember some lady, what's your problem? I ran crying home, you know? I didn't come to your door for that. I came for candy. But for whatever reason, you know, we can go into the history of Halloween, but we won't. That's not my intention. But something else is that we could commemorate today. In 1517, there was a Catholic monk, right? And a Catholic monk who had been wrestling through the issues of the day. And this particular monk was trying to figure out why it was that you would have to pay indulgences to have your sins forgiven, that faith in God alone wasn't enough. But yet somehow these doctrines would come out that say, if you have faith in God, that's good, but then you need to give a little bit of money to the church to release your soul from hell, right? And then also, he was frustrated with the fact that the word of God was to be broken open for all people, but it was written in a language that nobody could read. And so he wasn't known from his contemporaries, he wasn't known as some sort of brainiac. He wasn't like the prominent monk of the day. He was just another monk, right, who had sold out to God. And he got frustrated one day, and he wrote a paper as a college professor. And that paper just so happened that in the town that he lived in, there was also a printing press. And that paper was duplicated over and over again. And guess what? It got into the hands of young people. And when young people read it, they're like, yeah, this doesn't make sense to me either. Why isn't faith in God enough? Why isn't his grace enough? Why would I be paying money to a corrupt system? Why? And they asked all the right questions. And as we know it, and as history reports it, that he goes to a door of a chapel and he nails 95 theses or his issues, 95 of them, and puts them on the door of that church. And Martin Luther, who we know today as the reformer. And today is the commemoration, I think it's 493 years ago that he did that. And from there, we see the Protestant Reformation, and much change came as a result. But I think the greatest change isn't the divisions that you can have between one denomination and the other. The change that has come was that the Word of God became available to all people. He quickly went away, and you just got to imagine the Holy Spirit empowered him to translate. He translated the Bible, put it into German. He wrote commentaries. He prolifically wrote hymns that just told of the theology, "A mighty fortress is our God." I know that you guys sing that all the time in youth group, don't you? Mighty fortress. These songs of old, almost 500 years old, but rich heritage. And so not only does the rest of popular society celebrate Halloween, but many church folk celebrate Reformation Day, a day where somebody stood up and said, enough, enough. I'm in this system. I'm in this broken system, and I'm going to say something about it. And I'm not just going to say it in a way that is ranting and raving, but I'm going to do it intelligently. And I'm going to trust that if my message is correct, that God will multiply. And God did. It wasn't the nailing on the walls that got the attention of the church at the time. Guess what it was? It was the printing press that got it into the hands of the masses and young people that were like, yeah, who's this Martin Luther? We'll follow him. And it started a revolution. So anyways, that's a little bit about that. But part of his strong point came out of Ephesians, and that's where I want to turn us to today in the remaining time that we have. So Ephesians chapter 2. This first part, it tells us who we are. And this morning, as you're sitting here listening with us, you might be a visitor, you might have been here since the day that the church started. And regardless, we can all use to hear this. We need to remind ourselves of the message. And the message of the gospel starts with the bad news, doesn't it? It starts with the bad news. The bad news has nothing to do with Jesus. He's all about the good news. The bad news has to do with about us and the condition of our heart. And you might find yourself remembering when you were there. For some, you might feel there right now, but there's hope today, and I want to get to that point of hope. But here's what Ephesians says. It says, "As for you, this is verse 1 of chapter 2, you were dead in your transgressions and sins." Let's just stop there for a minute. "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins." I'm not going to ask any show of hands or any war stories about your past, okay? Because we all have them. But I just want to ask you, we all have some sort of past where we walked away from God or maybe where we were in points of rebellion. But just think for a moment. Did you ever feel really alive? Did you ever feel like, yeah, this is the good life? You know what I mean? I'm not talking about sin not having an element of pleasure, because it does. Otherwise, who would sin, right? Sin brings with it for a time a sense of pleasure. It just bites real hard, real fast, and real long afterwards. So in that moment of your rebellion, did you feel alive? Did you feel like, yeah, this is it? Chances are you didn't. Chances are you felt like just a little bit more. If I could just get a little more pleasure, if I could just get a little bit more money, just get a little bit more, whatever, then I'd be in the good life, right? And so it paints a picture for us right off the bat that in the midst of our sin, we're dead. Sin equals death, and it kills us. It kills our soul. Verse 2 says, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of the world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work among those who are disobedient. When I think of what sin does to society around, when I think of what sin does to those who are completely lost, as I've shared with you before, it's a heartbreak. It's a heartbreak. It's a heartbreak to think of spiritual death. Physical death is difficult enough, right? But spiritual death carries with it a component that's far more tragic to me, because you're alive in the misery. Think about what spiritual death means. It means that you've got no ability to communicate with God. There's no connection with God. That you maybe desire something, but you can't connect with him because inside you're dead. And that's a horrific thought. It's a horrific thought. It's one of those kind of thoughts of being like in that place where you want to say something, but your words won't come out. You know what I mean? It's that torture. And as we look at what sin does, it tortures people. It's cruel. It's a cruel thought. And that you may know of some people who are absolutely tortured. You may know of some people who say the thing of, man, I pray all that. I talk to God all the time. But what is prayer? Prayer is communication, and communication has with it elements, doesn't it? It has the element of the sender and the receiver. Otherwise, it's not communication, right? You can have a monologue where I can do this and blah, 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 right? And that can just drop out, and it can just become empty words. But where it becomes communication is when it's received, right? And the moment that I send it and it's received by you, we trust that the power of the Holy Spirit causes words to come alive and just activate in our soul. That's communication, and that's spiritual communication. And where there's sin, we're alienated from God, we can have no spiritual communication. That's why you have people who might say, man, I talk to God all the time. I pray constantly. I pray to the man upstairs every morning. You know, I wake up and say this and that. I'm good. But yet there's still a profound emptiness inside, and there's an inability to really receive spiritually what's needed and to have the soul come alive. There's this other element. Let's look at Romans. Would you turn there with me to Romans chapter 5, verse 12? Romans 5, 12. It would be wise to mark these passages in your Bible so that you can get there quickly. So that when you have the opportunity somebody would tell you this readily, you know, that, man, I just feel empty inside or whatever, that you can explain this is kind of why. In fact, there's a whole story about it in the Bible, and it's been in there for over 2,000 years. Romans chapter 5, 12, it says, therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and that one man is mankind, it's Adam and Eve together, that sin entered the world through a choice, and death through sin. Link those two together always. You might not be walking in sin and then just fall down and kaputs and die, but there's an element of spiritual decay and death that comes in through our sin. And it says, and death came through sin, and in this way, death came to all men because all have sinned. All have sinned, and death has come to all. If you also turn to Colossians chapter 2, verse 3, you'll see it unfolded. I'm not going to read that whole thing, but in Colossians 2 and verse 3, it says the same kind of stuff. It says that death came, that we were made alive in Christ, we're forgiven, that Jesus came to cancel the written code that was against us. He came to redeem a situation. Now that you're there, let's turn to this one, though. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. Because there's this part that we don't often talk about in church, and maybe we should talk about it more. We rebuke the enemy. We tell that the enemy has no hold and so forth. But we have to remember that there's a power that's there that's contrary to God's power, that's in no way near equal to it, but it has an effect on you. And it definitely has an effect on those who don't know God. In fact, it's the very power that keeps them from knowing him. And this is what it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. That's why prayer is so important for those that you love and those that need a touch from God. That's why Martin Luther was so passionate about getting the word of God to all people so that they could really know the secrets. When I say secrets, it's not like it's hidden to keep it away from people, but so people could unlock, how do I walk? How do I walk free? How do I get out of spiritual death? These are the cries of the people that are around you, and they may even be the cries of your heart. And it's not enough just to maybe bring them in to church, although that's a good step. But they want to hear it from you. They want to understand why you're different. And they want to have that unlocked in them. And 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4 says, "The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers." What does that mean? The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers. We understand throughout Scripture that Satan has a particular hold on this earth. The way that theologians would explain it, it's like he's on a big chain. He can only go as far as God will allow him to go, but yet that chain, if you had a pit bull on a chain, and you wouldn't just go, oh, it's on a chain, so I'm just going to walk in the yard, right? You know what the ability of a pit bull is, do you? Is everybody good this morning? Yeah. Should we stand up and do some jumping jacks? Come on. Everybody good? I was talking about a pit bull. If a pit bull was on a chain, he gets meaner than if he was roaming free. And if a pit bull was on a chain and it was in a yard, you wouldn't step foot in the yard, more than likely. Even though the master of that dog could yank it back at any point in time, if he chose not to, that dog would bite you and it would hurt. Those dogs' heads are like that big, right? They're tall. It's like, ugh. That's the picture of that we get of the enemy. He has been given authority and a certain amount of dominion on this earth, but the ultimate authority is God's. And so as the non-believer in his sin roams around this world, he's playing in the yard of the pit bull. And even though the pit bull's on the chain, that pit bull still bites. And within his power, he blinds not just the physical eyes, he blinds the spiritual eyes, he blinds the minds of those that are captured in sin. That's why the stuff that we're doing with the Truth Project is important. It's important because it reminds us what the truth is, because our minds, in the condition that we were born into sin, are blinded. And those around you that don't follow God, that's why we're not surprised when they sin. That's why we're not surprised when they use foul language. That's why we're not surprised when they steal and when they kill and when they do all those things, because their minds are depraved and they're blinded. And man, what a hopeless situation if we were to close the book now, right? Because I've just explained the evening news. I've just explained the garbage that we're like, what, again, you know? Helicopter hovering over some situation, you know, a standoff with police with their big guns and somebody holding somebody hostage. And for whatever reason, this is just a side note, we love watching that stuff as entertainment in movies as well. You just think, wow, how exciting. We just watched this movie about somebody, you know, whatever. Do you follow me? Yeah. It's the world that we live in. It's the picture that we see. And it's right here in Scripture. Blinded minds, eyes that can't see spiritually dead, unable to communicate with God, and yet really trying hard to do it. That's why the New Age world religion and cults flourish in this environment, because if you could figure out a way to do it on your own, you would do it. I mean, don't we like flood the workout places after the first of the year? You know, we all renew our memberships and whatever else, because if we could do something to better ourselves, we'd do it for a couple of days. The same way we look at the world around you, we can look at our spiritual lives like that. If we could do something about it, we'd do it. So maybe I'll cut my knees and just sit there and walk in glass and stop eating and beat my body into submission or whatever it might be, outside of me trying really hard to please God. And I missed the most powerful message that was pounded on that door 493 years ago. It's grace. Faith alone through grace that gives you salvation, that opens the door to now a life where God can begin to transform and change you. It's a message that people need to hear. But our eyes have been blinded. So I've given you the bad news. Now, as we look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, we start to get into the good news. And I'll tell you what, oh, this message, just this, just to hear these words, is this like a cup of cold water for me, and I hope it is for you. Ephesians 2, 4, it says, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions." Whew. Man, there's hope. You know, this week I went to the mayor's prayer breakfast in Orange, and I get to go, pastors get invited to it. It's really cool. You know, we have a great city in that respect. And but anytime there's a large gathering of people, there's all kinds of agendas and whatever else going on. And so you can hear the talk and the different things. And it's, you know, for the most part, there's some good stuff going on, but some of it feels a bit fake or whatever. You know, it is what it is, right? I'm sure that some of this feels a little bit fake to some that are here today. Anywhere there's people, you get that politicking. But at one point in time, it came to the reading of the scriptures, right? And two guys got up and they just opened the word of God and they read it. And you know what? My soul inside, it's like, oh, he didn't preach on it, teach on it, just read scripture. And these words of God are so alive, and just read in the public forum like that is awesome. And so as I read this, listen to the words alive and take them on behalf of those that are spiritually dead and blinded, whether they're in our own city or whether they're your neighbors or whether you feel you're that person this morning. Receive it as words alive, that bad news hangs out and lingers as bad news if we didn't receive this next portion. But God, of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, that even when we were dead in our transgressions, it is by his grace that you've been saved. It would do us well to look at those words a little bit, because his great love, how great is the love the Father has lavished on us. It enables us to be called sons and daughters of God. You know, right now you may be in a trial that you want to feel his love, but his love feels distant. His love has gone nowhere. His love has gone nowhere. It's available. It's available to you. You know, the definition of love, according to the Bible, I'm going to read it. It says, to seek the highest good in the one loved. To seek the highest good in the one loved. That God is always interested in you as an individual. And you as an individual, everything that he allows to happen and that he does, if you'll submit to him, is somehow for your betterment. It's somehow because he's seeking the highest good in you. And that's where we go. We just throw up our arms. That's why it's good to lift our arms in worship, just to go, I don't get it, Lord, but I lift my voice, you know? We don't have to understand it, but we certainly have to yield to it. We have to surrender to it, because everything that he's got there is for a reason. And so the second part of it, God, who is rich in mercy. There's a Hebrew word called hesed, and that Hebrew word really illustrates the mercy of God. It's basically, if I could break it down for you, it's God really put up with the children of Israel. He put up with a whole lot of rebellion. He put up with a whole lot of following after false gods and whatever else. And he didn't do it because God's some divine enabler. He did it because his rich mercy. It's that word hesed that caused him to show his irresistible love, that he stuck with them even when they didn't stick with him. And I know that many are studying the book of Jeremiah right now, classic example of God sticking with his people and sticking with his prophet. And Jeremiah himself was lifting his hands going, what's the deal, Lord? You know what I mean? But yet continuing to wrestle and struggle. But when he writes in Lamentations, I just, there's this song, Ben wrote a song about it. And when it talks about the Lord's loving kindness and calling these things to mind and just that richness of who God is. Look at with me Lamentations chapter 3. And in the same way, hear the words of God over you and over those that you love. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 19. In the context of Jeremiah just giving this message to Judah, them not getting the picture, him feeling like he's the only one, him just really struggling. And you probably identify with him. Listen to what he writes. And he's writing again about that undeserved kindness or that loyal love of God. God is so loyal. He's so loyal. He's loyal to you. And his loyalty shown in his love. Lamentations 3:19, it says, I remember my afflictions and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I remember them, and when my soul is downcast within me. Sometimes we can just stop at verse 20. We remember that pretty good. I do. I can get into that stuff and just go, oh, you know. And just like Jeremiah, I feel like I'm the only one. But this is awesome because remember this. The enemy has blinded the minds of those that don't know him, don't know God. But your mind is redeemed. You have to live like it though, right? I've said this before, the message of the New Testament, you become a new creation in Christ. You've put on Christ, you're in Christ now. Now you just have to act like it. That's the message. And this is what Jeremiah says. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. What would we be in this world without hope? Because I'll tell you right now that there is a myriad of people that you encounter every single day that have no hope. They have no hope. Your situation might even look like theirs sometimes, but the difference between you and them is that you can continue to thrive. Why? Because you have hope. And this you call to mind, and therefore you have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we're not consumed. What does consumed mean? Wiped out. It's that feeling when somebody's like swearing and cursing God and you're nearby and you're like, whoa, I want to get away from you to avoid the lightning bolt, right? It's because of the Lord's great and loyal love for all mankind that guy that may be cursing and swearing like that doesn't get consumed. That there's still an opportunity for the worst of us, for the worst of us to be redeemed. You know what? And sometimes the worst of us are closest to redemption. Sometimes that guy who's just, or lady, you know, who swears like a sailor and drinks like a fish and whatever else is just like that close, just that close. And this will I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we're not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. And then he goes on to say, great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those who hope in him, and the Lord is the one who seeks him, and to the one who seeks him, excuse me. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Do not lose hope. Do not lose hope. Never lose hope. Never lose hope. Never. Never. His compassions never fail. His mercies never fail. He is loyal in his love. Never lose hope, but surrender, yes. Give up, yes. Give up trying to figure it out, yes. Remind yourself to do that. Remind your friends to do that. Help one another to do that, yes. Tell of the faithfulness of God. It helps us to go, yeah, I don't get it, but yet I will still follow you, yet I still love you. Ephesians 2:6, it says, and God raised up Christ and seated him in the heavenly realms with Jesus Christ. Sorry, let me try that again. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. And here's where Martin Luther would just go, thanks for saying it. Verse 8, for it is by grace you've been saved through faith. Think about that just for a minute. It is by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves, but it's a gift of God. It's not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he prepared in advance for us to do. I got more to say, but I'm just going to stop there. I'm going to invite Ben to come forward with the worship team, and I'm going to end with that. And I'm going to invite you to look at this passage, to really make it your own, to really let this be the lenses that you look at the world around you through. There's grace. There's grace for you. There's grace for those that have yet to even know God. It's his grace that draws them. It's his kindness that leads them to repentance. Does that kindness sometimes look like you grabbing your friend who's totally blowing it and just shaking him and saying, you're an idiot and you need to stop doing what you're doing in love? Absolutely. I've had friends and loved ones that have done that to me before. And I know that they love me, and I know that that's what's gonna break through. Does his grace and his kindness sometimes look like you maybe holding back at times and just, I'm going to let that go, but I'm going to pray more fervently than I prayed yesterday? Yes, it looks like that too. And for you who maybe you're here today and you're wondering, is that grace for me? Yeah, it's for you. It's for you. It's for you to experience right now that if there is any bit in your life where you feel spiritually dead, where you feel shut off from God, where you feel like you can't have dialogue or communication with God, His grace is enough for you. It's more than enough. And the very thing that keeps us from walking in relationship with God is us. If you were to be handed a gift, you'd have to receive it in order to enjoy it. Gosh, we've said this so many times, but you could have the most awesome gift and never unwrap it, never know what it is. Maybe it's that See's candy box, right? Oh, I know what it is. It's See's candy. It's the right shape. It's the same See's candy wrapper paper, right? I'm not going to open it. I don't want to eat that candy right now, so I'm just going to leave it there. You know how around Christmas time you might get 14,000 of those and you have them stacked up somewhere. They all look the same. But who knows? Maybe someone was pulling a fast one on you and they put $1 million in your See's candy box, but you never knew because you never unwrapped it and you never took it home, so you could never enjoy it. Why? Because the bottom line for most of us is our pride gets in the way from the help that we need. Our pride, because guess what? We know it. We know what we need. We know what's best for us. We got it all sorted out. We got it figured. No, we don't. No, we don't. In fact, we know very little about anything. The smartest people in the world will tell you that we know very little about anything. The smartest scientist in the world about things like DNA will say we're discovering things, but we know very little about that. The wisest of theologians that could come and preach to you on a Sunday morning would say, I'm just scratching the surface at the knowledge of God. The Word of God itself says that had we had had more been written about the wonderful works of Jesus, then the shelves of the world couldn't contain the volumes that were written about who He was. We know very little. And it's so wise for us to just be humble. It's so wise for you that this morning, if you are feeling spiritually dead inside, that you would reach out to God and receive the gift of His grace. It's not anything that you can do. It's not your works. You can't boast in it. It's a gift from God. It's salvation by grace through faith. And faith is this, believing, believing. It's believing in what you can't yet see as if it were right now. And He, by His Spirit, even helps us in the whole process to do it. And so this morning, would you just reach out to God? And would you receive His Word? Would you receive His Word whether you don't know Him or whether you do? If you do know Him and you're struggling, remind yourself of this, that you are His workmanship created to do good works in Christ. I had the opportunity yesterday to go to, of all places, the convent at Sisters of St. Joseph's. There's a nun that I've talked about before that I work with at the police department as a police chaplain. And she invited me over. And so I went over and she actually came here and looked around. And I only share that to say this, that there was this beautiful sculpture there. And as we walked through, it was a sculpture of a heart that was half done. In other words, it was this big rock, a block. And this one half was perfectly shaped. And the other half was this rough rock thing. And Sister Joan is just down to earth. She goes, I don't get that thing. I don't know what that is. But anyways, here's where we do this. And here's where we care for the poor. And here's where we... And I just stopped for a minute. I had my daughter Kate with her. And she was just kind of the artist that she is, just pondering it. And she says, what is it, Dad? And I said, I think that's how Jesus works on our heart. That we're His workmanship. That we're on His workbench. And He's creating good works for us to do. And He's not finished with us, Kate. He's not finished. He's doing a really good job though, isn't He? Look at this first half, how perfect it is. And she said, yeah, but look at the other half, how messed up it is. I said, that's the other half that he's working on. You are His workmanship. The Greek word is poema. You're His poem. You're His work of art. And He's chiseling away. Just hang in there. Just hang in there because you have hope. This will you call to mind, and therefore you'll have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, you're not consumed. His compassions never fail. His mercy is new every morning. Receive it. Just receive this morning. I'm not going to ask you to do cartwheels, backflips, kneel, stand, sit, whatever. I'm just going to ask you to receive the gift of God by His grace and let Him talk to you. And as Ben leads us in this song, just open your heart to more of Jesus.
And here I am waiting. Abide in me, I pray. And here I am longing for you.
as we stand together in the presence of God. Come live in me, all my life take over. That's what the song says, and I know some of you sang it. And if you've sung that for the first time and just saying, Jesus, come take over, receive the gift of salvation today. Confess that you know you need him. Confess that you're a sinner. That might sound like an ugly word, but it is what it is. Sin is ugly and it blinds us and it hurts other people. And we have got no other solution for it outside of God. But just by confessing our sin, he's faithful and just to cleanse us and forgive us of our unrighteousness. So that may be something you need to do. And then it says to confess with your mouth and believe with your heart that he is the Son of God. That invites him to come in and to become the Lord of your life. So that as you sing that song, it's true. You're saying, come live in me and take over my life. And what a good job he does at leading us if we'll follow him. And for the rest of us, God, that already know you, and maybe we've fallen off the path, we've lost our way, we ask you now, Holy Spirit, to strengthen us, straighten our path, that you guide us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. So make straight the crooked path for us, God, that we might walk with you in purity and in strength. Bless your people today, God, and ask that you just give them a tremendous amount of hope. Hope in your goodness and your faithfulness and your loyal love and your undeserved kindness through your mercy that's made new every morning. I thank you for it in the name of Jesus. And before you leave, a couple of things. We're going to have this harvest today. And as we do, it's going to be a great opportunity for us as a church to interact with our community. And listen, you don't have to pin somebody in the corner and give them the four spiritual laws, but if you feel led to do it, you go ahead. Just do it in love. But what a great opportunity to show the mercy and love and grace of God to people as they interact and they come and let their kids have a fun time and play. So be God's ambassadors today. Use the hospitality that the Holy Spirit's put in you. And if you're helping out to volunteer, go and get a bite to eat and then come back and help because they need you. And we're going to look forward to a great time. So I know I already prayed, but I just want to pray a blessing over that time and then we'll dismiss you. And I want to say one other thing. Jessie Keen was listening today, I think, on the, and if you don't know who Jessie Keen is, Jessie's away at college at UCLA, just down the road here. And so Jessie, we're glad you listened with us today. So let's pray for Jessie, let's pray for this time together later this evening, and then we'll dismiss. Father God, we thank you. God, we thank you for an opportunity to reach out to our neighbors today and just to bless them with the candy and the fun and whatever else. But hopefully God will bless them with an experience with believers that they'll go, wow, those people are awesome. And I want whatever they have. Would you open up opportunities for us today and this evening? And we bless each one. We pray your favor be upon everybody today in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. God bless you. Come live.